It has to get out. And that's where I am this morning. Can't wait to be able to bring the message to you this morning. It's exciting. I'm going to invite you to open your Bibles to the book of Acts. The book of Acts and chapter 16. As you're turning there, I came across something during the time that Shelley and I were away on our conference. One of the speakers was bringing this particular psalm. It's a psalm that deals with the issue of really understanding the battle that we're in and the protection that we have from God. It's Psalm 91. It says, "Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God, and I trust him." Just think about those words. He is a shelter. He is really the person in which we walk beside, and we are literally in his shadow, which means that we're never alone. We are constantly in his presence. And so because of that, we do not have to lose hope. This morning, I want to start with an Irish blessing. It's a quote that I have here. If you take a look at it, it says, "May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. And then, of course, may the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand." Isn't that beautiful? It's just this whole idea of God's protection. And sometimes we think, if life were only like this, more often than not, the blasts of life and reality hits us, unfortunately, right in the face. In fact, there are times in ministry that it knocks us back and it sends us scurrying for cover. In fact, that is what Paul and his fellow missionaries must have felt like as they return now in their second missionary journey. They tried to bring the gospel message to Asia, but you remember that gust after gust had closed the door. Finally, it blew them to the Aegean coast. And then suddenly the winds changed, as Luke records it in his log. And it's given for us in Scripture. Take a look in your Bibles, beginning with verse number 11 of chapter 16. He writes, "We boarded a boat at Troas, and we sailed straight across to the island of Samothrace. And the next day we landed at Neapolis. From there we reached Philippi, a major city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. And we stayed there several days." Now, it's interesting, they begin to set sail. It says that they made a straight course. It's very interesting in the text. The Greek word is the word ethrohudmo, and it means that they sailed, they ran a straight course. It's a nautical term. It means they sailed before the wind, and it brought them through to their desired destination. And so the winds were at their back, the obstacles and friction were gone. How free and confident they must have been as they were led along with the warm breeze of propelling blowing. This is an amazing scene. It seems like everything is moving the way it should. Isn't that great when things like that happen? Someone once said that, what do you do and how do you describe it when you've just gone through a difficulty or a trial and you're waiting for the next one to come? How do you explain that? Well, it's simply the understanding that Satan is reloading. He's reloading, okay? He's getting ready because there's going to be another one. We enjoy them when they come, but we realize that before we know it, we are in another storm. And remember, this is the Christian life. The Christian life is not a life where everything is now going to be easy, nice, and beautiful, and comforting, and we just kind of go through life until the rapture happens. No, this is a warfare, folks. Sometimes we consume ourselves with the idea of pleasure, and there's nothing wrong with pleasure, but we have to understand that in this life, it's a warfare. The real vacation is coming, but right now is a time for action and work and facing obstacles. And that's exactly the kinds of things that are coming. The passage opens with the missionary team. And if you remember from last week, Paul, Silas, Timothy, and Luke, and they are in the city of Troas. If you look behind me, it's an interesting place. Troas was located across the Aegean Sea from Greece. It was on the western shore of Asia Minor, which is today's modern Turkey. It was near the site of ancient Troy. The missionaries had been directed there, if you remember, by the Holy Spirit, who had closed all of the other doors. Remember that Paul had a vision. Now, I want you to pay very close attention to this. It was a guy from Macedonia on the mainland of Greece, and he was pleading, come over here to Macedonia and help us. And in response to the vision, Luke notes, immediately we sought to go to Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. And so because of God's call, putting out to sea from Troas, they immediately ran straight course to a place called Samothrace. Samothrace is an island in the Aegean Sea. It's approximately halfway between Asia Minor and the Greek mainland. And the Bible says that they stayed overnight to avoid the hazards of sailing, of course, in the dark. And on the day following, they sailed on to Neapolis. You see there on the map. It's a port city there for Philippi. And so the winds must have been favorable for the reverse trip from Philippi to Troas on the third missionary journey took 5 days. So this, they immediately were able to get through without any problem. And so the missionary team landed in Neapolis, and Paul's ministry finally reached Europe. So the team did not stop to preach, by the way, in Neapolis. But from there, they went on to Philippi, by the way, about 10 miles inland to Philippi. And Luke notes that it was a leading city, the district of Macedonia. It's a Roman colony. By the way, it was named after Philip II of Macedon. He was the father of Alexander the Great. Philippi was the eastern limit for the great Roman highway known as the Aegean Way. Now, although 8 or more cities were known to the Roman colonies, they appear in Acts. Philippi is the only one that Luke is referring to here as a colony. And so the initial impact, you take a look at the next picture, we get to Philippi, and this is very important for you to see this. This is an ancient spot. It's built up on a hill, and you'll kind of notice down below there are several different places in which people did worship. And remember, this is a pagan culture. This is a culture that does not know God. It is dealing with ancient understandings of many gods. And so this particular place of Philippi, situated on a sizable hill, was a natural military outpost. Soldiers were a common sight in this particular area. It had all the trappings of a Roman culture, and it was marked by the symbols of immorality and paganism, as we're going to look at in a moment. So into this city walked 4 Christians. First followers of Jesus Christ, anyone in this part of the world is seen. How in the world should Paul and his partner share the gospel here? Few Jews lived in Philippi. Where would they begin? Look at verse 13. On the Sabbath, we went a little way outside the city to a riverbank where we thought people would be meeting for prayer. And we sat down to speak with some women who had gathered there. Now, just keep this in the back of your mind. What was Paul's directive for going into the area? It was the call, right? Somebody needed help. And all of a sudden, we see Paul now. He's involved in this particular area where he's going to prayer, and he finds women here, which is very interesting. The Riverside was the Jewish community that did not have a minimum of even 10 Jewish people living there. But this was a place of prayer under the open sky and near a river or the sea, and it was adopted as this meeting place. Most likely, this was the spot located where the road leading out of the city crossed the river, and women met there. Evidence of a small number of Jewish men. It was the women who met to pray. It's interesting. They went to worship. They went to recite the Old Testament scriptures. You see, at this time, there had already been a flux of the fall of Adam. Listen to this carefully. There is a natural tendency for the woman to usurp authority. That's part of what happened in Genesis 3, right? So this continues through all of life, even into the 21st century. What you see happening is the men started taking a back seat and the women were coming forward to lead. And this is going to play a very important part as churches start to get developed. It even comes into the whole understanding of the 21st century church where it deals with women in leadership. It's never been an issue of women being capable in leadership. Let me just tell you that. Women are probably more capable than men, just to be honest. But the reality is that God wants the male headship and the leadership role. And what was already beginning here in this first century Christianity was the women were the ones coming out for prayer. So the women worshiped. The only women are mentioned is further evidence of that small group that were there. Now look at your notes. These women were led to do three things. They were led to do three particular things. First of all, they met to pray. Number two, they read from the Old Testament law. And then number three, they discussed what they read. Kind of sounds like something that we all do, right? What is it called? Bible study. Exactly. So women, Tuesday mornings, you should outnumber the men. The idea is the importance of Bible study. They understood that reading scripture and talking and discussing it was very, very important. To be taught, by the way, by a rabbi such as Paul was no doubt a rare privilege. And so the women are going to be the ones helped first before this man that had called to Paul. And that brings us to what I'm so excited about. Be in your notes. It's called sovereign salvation. What you are about ready to experience in the scriptures with me this morning is the incredible way in which God saves people. It is so awesome. It should end all confusion about the whole issue of the doctrine of election, which often divides Christians. This is a beautiful thing that we see from God. Verse 14 introduces a certain woman named Lydia. Let's take a look at it. Verse 14, one of them was Lydia from Thyatira, a merchant of expensive purple cloth, that's important to know, who worshiped God. Now look at this carefully. As she, what? Listened to us. The Lord opened her heart. And here's the result from her perspective. This is now her perspective in her choosing, her responsibility and her salvation. From her perspective, she accepted what Paul was saying. And then, of course, Scripture shows us the order, verse 15, and she and her household were baptizo, immersed, baptized. And she asked us to be her guests. Now look at this. If you agree that I am a true believer in the Lord, she said, come and stay at my home. And she urged us until we agreed. Look at this. There is so much going on in this particular part of the text. These two verses are critical to see how God's open door moved the Spirit's power of changing a heart. This is how conversion happens. There are three sequential aspects of Lydia's conversion that stand out. Number one, take a look at this in your notes. She was a worshiper of God. Now remember, you can be a worshiper of God and not necessarily be saved. We've been talking about this several weeks. She worshiped God. She had already turned from pagan idolatry to worship the one true God. And so the phrase, a worshiper of God, shows that Lydia, like Cornelius, remember back in Acts 10, was a believer in the God of Israel, but not in a saving way yet. This, by the way, needs to be clarified because we deal with it in our own day. There are many people who believe in God and believe in Christ and believe in the creeds and the confessions and go to church and are not saved yet. Because salvation involves God opening the heart, changing the person to think differently and to act differently. And this is why there is so much easy believism. Randy, we've been teaching this in the Sunday school class about what our church doesn't believe in, and we don't believe in what's called easy believism. It's not just a simple, I love Jesus, I throw a pine cone into the fire, and now I'm good. It's not a simple whim of saying, well, I believe in this Jesus because, you know, I'm in a difficult situation right now, and so this works for me now. No, this is something that is different. God is the one who is pursuing her. She is not seeking. God is doing the drawing. Can I remind you of the scripture behind me in John chapter 6, verse 44, Jesus' words? No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. That word is the word helko, which means literally drag. And I will raise him up on the last day. And then later in that same chapter, it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. What does that mean? I can't choose nothing because I'm dead in my transgressions and sins. And I don't know about you, but not many dead people can do anything. They can't move. They can't make a choice. They can't get up. They can't do anything. They're dead. And the only way that they can do anything is if God resurrects them first, right? Remember Ezekiel, the dead bones, the dry bones? And they're dead, they can't come to life. And then what happens? The Spirit gets breathed on those bones. And they start to rattle and they start to come together and flesh starts to build on them. And before long, it's a great army. What this is a representative of is we are dead. And dead people can't choose. And so number two, not only was she a worshiper of God, but she was listening. This is very important. She listened to us. This is the key work of the Holy Spirit. The listening comes from hearing. Specifically hear. The word hear is very important. It is the word akustos. It means to receive news, normally by word of mouth. It means to pay attention to something, to believe and to respond, to obey, to listen carefully. This is the opposite of necessarily hearing sound. I find myself in this difficult situation that I'll confess to you this morning. Shelly will be sitting in the car and she'll be talking and she'll be explaining something and she'll say, now, honey, what did I just say? That's a terrible thing to say. Honey, what did I just say? I heard her talking. I heard her speaking. Right? But it went in one ear and out the other. It was sounds that resonated into my ear. And the ear did what it was supposed to do. But the problem was, is it never got from here to here. And then you have to do that terrible thing. Honey, I was thinking at the time, I was thinking of something else. Can you repeat that? And then I have to hear, oh, I'm so tired of you not listening to me. How many other husbands have this problem? No, never mind. Don't show your hands. Isn't that awful? You can hear, but what was going on here with this Greek word here is that it is something that is actually penetrating the ears, going in the heart. I am processing it. And when my mind processes it, the Holy Spirit is the one that ignites it to turn on the light switch. It's the same word that is used in Matthew chapter 18, verse 15, if you take a look at it behind me. If another believer sins against you, go privately and point out the offense. If the other person listens and confesses it, you have won that person back. It's something that has gone into the heart. And so Paul spoke about the necessity of preaching the word to an open heart. Hold your place in the book of Acts and just turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And as you're turning there, we are going to be looking at verse number 18. And I want to show you, as you're looking at this and looking for the text, that something is very important here, because a person can hear the gospel. They can even process the gospel and understand the gospel, but it still may not change them. The Holy Spirit's the one that chooses for them to actually get it. And that's what Paul's going to be talking about here. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 18. Take a look at it. The message of the cross to those who are headed for destruction, it's foolishness. The cross is foolish to those, because we know that those that are being saved, it is the very power of God. As the scriptures say, look at it. I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, discard the intelligence of the intelligent. So where does this leave the philosophers, the scholars, the world's brilliant debaters? God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish, since God in his wisdom saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom. So he used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. He's basically saying that the belief happens after the preaching comes and the Holy Spirit ignites it. So this is what's happening. It's foolishness to other people. That's why it doesn't sometimes affect anybody when we give them the gospel, because they're not listening in the way that the Holy Spirit is actually activating it. Now listen carefully. Many hear the sound of the life-giving message preached without really listening to it. They are like Paul's companions on the Damascus Road. You remember that? They're all walking. They heard its sound, but look at the text behind me in Acts 22:9. Look at what it says. And those who were with me saw the light, to be sure, but did not understand the voice of the one who was speaking to me. And so this is the same type of situation. Lydia was not like them. She listened with faith to the saving gospel. And as a result, look at number 3 in your notes. Because of this, the Lord opened her heart to respond. God is absolutely sovereign in salvation. And were that not true, no one would be saved. Because again, if you're dead in your sins, you're unable to respond to spiritual truth. Is that hard to understand? Take a look behind me, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins. It cannot get any clearer than that. God has to open the heart. Listen to this commentator. Remembering God's sovereignty and salvation is the fountain of a proper perspective on evangelism. So listen to this. Salvation does not depend on clever evangelistic strategies, or the skill of the preacher, or a masterful presentation. It is not a human work at all. It is God's work. I planted, Paul wrote to the Corinthians. Apollos watered, but God was causing the growth. So then neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything but God who causes the growth. Paul was ridiculed because he couldn't preach very well. This is Apostle Paul. It says that most of the time when he got up, he stumbled in his words and he was trembling all the time. How many people would hire a pastor like that to preach? And yet it was the power of God, because God used the inadequacies of the human nature of Paul to get the message. It's always like God to do that. He uses the things that people would think aren't very effective. Like, these ideas of evangelism. We'll have a big tent meeting. We'll have all kinds of stuff. We're going to do all these kind of things. What about just the simple preaching of the Bible? Right? Because the Word of God is sufficient. Most important element of any gospel is the clarity of the content. To present the gospel clearly, and it requires invoking the power of the Holy Spirit and leaving the results to God. That's so refreshing because it doesn't depend on how convincing you might be. Isn't that great? You don't have to ever worry about that. You just have to give the truth. And so the inevitable results of her open heart was the ability to respond. And this, by the way, in Reformed circles is called irresistible grace. Irresistible grace is just something that when the Holy Spirit is opening the heart, you're not going to be able to go in there and say, oh, by the way, let's close it. Irresistible grace simply means when God does something to open up your heart, it can't be reversed. It's irresistible. It's inevitable. It's like a magnet. You're going to go to it. That's why the Bible says no one seeks after God. Once regeneration happens and I am actually saved, now I am seeking after God. It's irresistible. I can't stay away from it. And that's why we say in the church the only way we can judge salvation is to find out how many people are passionate about it. How many people are passionate about the Word of God? How many people are really wanting to be part of it? You can't resist it. You can't stay away from it. That's one of the signs of true salvation. You can't stay away from church. You can't stay away from the Word. You can't stay away from it. It's irresistible. And so, verse 15, back to our text. Take a look. It says, and she and her household were baptized. And she asked us to be guests. It mentions her and her household. I'm going to give you a test question today. Now, normally on Wednesdays, we do trivia and we give away pies. Don't worry, Shelly, I'm not going to give away any pies tonight. This is just a question, okay? You ready for this one? All right, you're all with me. Since baptism follows conversion, did those in her household hear the word of God preached by Paul? Yes or no? They're all saying, I don't dare answer this. Yes. If they were saved and they were baptized, that means that the message must have been preached to them. That's one of the problems that we have in understanding baptism. Is some people say, well, it talks about them and their household were baptized. So there must have been infants there. So let's just assume that the infants must be baptized. No, it's talking about a correlation of hearing, understanding, and accepting. Then it was baptism. It was the understanding that they heard the gospel message, Lydia and her household. Whenever you see that, by the way, in the book of Acts, we'll be seeing it later in the book of Acts where it says them and their whole household believed. It means that the whole household that was there included people that could understand the gospel, process the gospel, and accept Christ. And baptism followed the conversion. It always has. And so, this is God selecting Lydia, her heart, the hearts of her family, open to Jesus, and because of her hospitality, the missionaries now had a base of operations. By the way, you can still have an infant in a family, and there could be other people in the family of that household that accept Christ, and you can still consider it a household. You don't assume that babies are there or not there. And so the first open door was a success. As we're going through this, we're going to be seeing four principles. And here's the first principle from Paul's action. Number one, beginning a ministry requires wisdom. Paul could have set his mind to find that man from Macedonia, refusing to speak with these women. And instead, he wisely altered his methods to match the situation. Isn't that amazing? This was flexibility combined with a sensitive leading of the Spirit. And those are the hallmarks to a wise person, a wise leader. That brings us to number two, and this is incredible, the pressing opposition. You are going to see demonism. You are going to see demonic action. And let me just say, there's a lot more of this kind of thing going on than we would understand or even know within the 21st century world. Let me just say this quickly as an aside. Oftentimes when people think of demonic action, you think of all kinds of horror movie kind of things with twisted faces and all that. That's not the way it usually works with demonic oppression. It's usually subtler than that. It's things that are going on in the mind, causing the individual to want to take their life or to bring them down to a path that they ought not to go. It's more subtle. And unfortunately, it's looked at as psychological. It just is. The EMS people that were in our yard a couple years ago dealing with this child that was possessed, what do you think they're going to do? Forget it. They drugged him up as soon as they got him into the ambulance with four people, a police officer trying to get him in there. They drugged him up, sent him to Pine Rest or wherever it is, and they'll have some psychological thing, but this kind of stuff happens all the time. So let's take a look at it. They're excited by their success. The missionaries continue to meet with their new little flock, and then something happens. Satan moves in to attack it. Remember the winds? Like subtly coming upon them, Luke now tells us that these shifting winds have a result. Look at verse 16 now. Of the text. One day, as we were going down to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit, you can use the word demon, that enabled her to tell the future. So there are some things that the demonic world are able to do. She earned a lot of money, and I would underline that statement. She earned a lot of money for her masters by telling fortunes. Now, she followed Paul. Now, this is interesting. She followed Paul and the rest of us shouting, "These men are servants of the Most High God, and they have come to tell you how to be saved." Does that sound like something a demon would say? It's really cool when you start seeing what's going to happen here. So this woman is doing this. These guys are from not just any God. They're from the Most High. She's speaking truth. There's no lie here. So look at this. A certain slave girl having a spirit of divination, the original text says. The Greek text literally reads a python spirit. Paul used that designation with pagan origins from Greek mythology. You have to understand this word. It's the word puthon, really, literally in the Greek, puthon. And a puthon was a fortune teller, is one possessed or stirred by puthon, a spirit that communicated through the Delphic oracles. And that's important to know where we are. Take a look behind me so I can explain this oracle at Delphi Pyx. In Greek mythology, the python was a snake that guarded the famous oracle at Delphi. Eventually, the python was killed by Apollo, the god of prophecy. Since it was believed that Apollo spoke through the oracle at Delphi, the term python came to refer to anyone in contact with Apollo. And in modern terms, she was a medium that was in contact with demons. If you look at the next picture here, this is the actual ruins of the actual place where they conducted this worship. Still stands today. Isn't that interesting? You can kind of see the outward area there of the hill. This is kind of down in that little part that we saw in that last picture. And this is the temple. This is the remaining temple that exists there. So apparently this demon was speaking through this young slave woman and giving her the ability to forecast the future. I need to take you to this. Merrill Unger, who has phenomenal books on demonology, lets us in on an insight. Listen to his words. Paul's encounter with the mediumistic fortune teller at Philippi demonstrates that not everything in fortune telling is fraud and humbug. Real fortune telling powers are demonic. The girl told the truth, receiving her knowledge from demons. Her commendation of Paul and Silas as servants of the Most High God demonstrates the subtlety of Satan in gaining followers for later deception. The incident shows how Satan frequently parades as an angel of light, especially under the guise of alleged religiosity. To us, her announcement seems helpful to the cause of Christ. This has always been a text that has troubled me. How can a demon declare truth like this? She's telling people where they can find salvation for their souls. But look at your notes very carefully. It was really a clever ruse of Satan. It was a ruse. It was deception. In fact, it was designed to infiltrate the church. Notice in the text, and they, these men, have come to tell you how to be saved. Literally, the Greek says, proclaiming to you a way of salvation. That's the way it originally reads. It's so helpful to know the Greek here. It's not the way of salvation, but a way. Very important. Satan uses a little truth to ensnare people in a false system. You have a way, we have a way, let's join forces together. That happens in the 21st century. Listen carefully. Some of his most effective and diabolical work is done in the name of Jesus Christ. He often uses a little truth to ensnare people in a false system of religion. And since the demon-possessed girl was agreeing with the Christian preachers, the natural assumption would be that the woman was part of their group, that she would be in a position now to harm the cause of Christ. Again, quickly, turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Because Paul talks about these kinds of people. Now listen to this, take a deep breath. These people are infiltrated in churches. You ready for this? 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Verse number 13. These people are false apostles. They are deceitful workers who disguise themselves as apostles of Christ. But I am not surprised. Even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. So it is no wonder that his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness. In the end, they will get the punishment their wicked deeds deserve. This is why church leadership is so important, to be able to discern truth from error, even when it sounds plausible. And so this is very, very important. Exorcism, let's bring to the next part. Paul presents the words to the satanic assault. He felt sorry for the state of this girl. And by the way, he ended both of them. Look at chapter 16 back in our text, verse number 18. As they went on day after day until Paul was so exasperated that he turned and said to the demon within her, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And look at the text, and instantly it left her. Instantly. Please understand that what Paul is doing has been given to him by God. It is not the common way that we are not apostles. We have no right to command anything. We go to our daddy. We go to our father and say, look at the stuff that's going on here. We have no right. These entities have been around for a long, 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 long time. They know the Bible better than any of us. And they're tricky. We don't have the authority to command anything out. And I know that goes against a lot of the 21st century ideas about casting out demons, but we don't do that. We simply do what we're supposed to do, which is pray and read scripture, and we go to our Father. These guys have been anointed to do this. That was part of authenticating their apostleship. So that's exactly what Paul does. Look at the word instantly here. It's the word autos in the Greek. It's an immediate action. At that very moment, Paul's method of casting out the wicked spirit. Look at your notes, four things. He was not intimidated, and yet he was in full control. Number two, Paul spoke directly to the demon, not to the girl. Number three, he commanded it to come out of her. He didn't ask. Number four, this is the most important part. He drew on Jesus' power, not his own strength. If he would have done it in his own strength, he would have been like the seven scribes of Sceba who got beaten up by the demons when they tried to cast him out. And in an instant, the demon, the voice, the fortune-telling ability is gone. And that brings us to the second principle. Number two, in every major breakthrough, there is a corresponding resistance. And we're going to see that. For every step forward, the devil will meet you halfway. For every new strategy you implement, he will mount a corresponding counterattack. We are never to be intimidated by his evil presence, and we are never to give in. We stand only in Christ's power. And I love this scripture, folks. This is very important. Look behind me. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. But you belong to God. My dear children, you have already won a victory over these people, the fighting against the flesh and the blood was really a spiritual attack. Because the Spirit, Holy Spirit, who lives in you is greater than the Spirit who lives in the world. Isn't that great? You got the Holy Spirit living inside of you. That trumps anything. That takes care of anything. And that brings us to the third part, the physical pain and the maltreatment. Mistreatment. This is very difficult. With the demon gone, you would think that there would be relief. Not. Verse 19. Her master's hopes of wealth were now shattered. Look at this carefully. So they grabbed Paul and Silas and dragged them before the authorities at the marketplace. The whole city is in an uproar because of these Jews, they shouted to the city officials. They are teaching customs that are illegal for us Romans to practice. A mob quickly formed against Paul and Silas, and the city officials ordered them stripped and beaten with wooden rods. Look at verse 23. They were severely beaten, and then they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was ordered to make sure they didn't escape. So the jailer put them into the inner dungeon and clamped their feet in the stocks. I don't have a picture of this, but this was not a comfortable place. It was dark, dirty, dingy, and so that they couldn't have any freedom of movement, their feet were shackled. Not exactly a good reward for casting out a demon. Yet this is an incredible thing. There are three volatile elements that are combined to stir up this storm of trouble. I want you to see it in your notes. The first one was greed. The girl's master didn't care about her at all. She was just a tool that kept making them money. As long as the money kept flowing in, they were good, but now Paul messed that up, so they want revenge. Number two, there was prejudice. They slipped in the part that these men were Jews, these Jews. And then number three, exaggeration and lies. Paul was not throwing them into confusion. He was simply speaking the truth. The people that were being thrown into confusion were these people that were no longer making money. And such slander convinced the townspeople that the missionaries were dangerous. They were infiltrators, deserving punishment. There's no attempt to hear the facts, to hold a court session. The mob attacked them and threw them into prison. And now, folks, this is amazing. And I want this to sink in very carefully this morning, because many of us find ourselves in this part here, the dungeon part. How would you feel after this kind of treatment? Rats scurry across that dark floor, can't move. Verse 25, around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying, and look at this, singing hymns to God. Now look at it. The other prisoners were listening. They were listening. It was going from the ear to the heart. They were listening. Now, how in the world could Paul and Silas start praying and singing hymns? in a situation like this, I could think of a ton of things that I could be doing rather than praying or singing, like complaining, griping, oh, Lord, this isn't fair. What in the world are you doing? But in the midst of their pain, rejoicing. And the inmates listened. Even in prison, the gospel is shining. And there are two presiding reasons that they could rejoice in this kind of suffering. Remember this, folks. Star it in your notes. Here it is. Number one, their steadfast trust in God's sovereign hand. If it's happening, it's sovereignty. It may seem unfair, but it's sovereignty. And once you realize that, Elizabeth Elliot's quote, in acceptance lies peace. You accept what's going on as being allowed by the hand of God. Number two, they knew whether free or in shackles that they belong to God. Is this how you and I act? I belong to God. I'm a child of God. I'm going through some pretty heavy stuff, but I'm a child of God. Doesn't seem like it's fair, but here I am. And that brings us to the deliverance and salvation. And this is amazing, folks. As they sang and prayed, a divine earthquake shook the foundations of the prison. Look at verse 26. Suddenly there was a massive earthquake and the prison was shaken, look at it, to its foundations. This is amazing. And all the doors immediately flew open and the chains of every prisoner fell off, exclamation point in the original language. This is amazing. Following such a supernatural event, we'd expect the prisoners to leave the prison, right? The jailer assumes that this has occurred, and remember, we've talked about this before. He prepares to kill himself. Look at verse 27. It would have been his head if they would have flew out of there. The jailer woke to see the prison doors wide open. He assumed, that was his first problem, that the prisoners had escaped, so he drew his sword to kill himself. Look at this. Watch this divine intervention, verse 28. But Paul shouted to him, stop, don't kill yourself, we're all here. The jailer called for lights and ran to the dungeon and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them out and asked, sirs, look at this. What must I do to be saved? A jailer who woke up. Look at verse 31. Here's our word. They replied, pistos. Believe in the Lord Jesus. Not mental assent. Not agreeing with the fact of the gospel, but it's the transforming power of renewal. Living it out. Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. And if you tell that message to your family, along with everyone in your household. He simply said, if you and your household believe, you understand, and you give your life to Christ, all of you will be saved. And they shared the word of the Lord with him and all who lived. Look at it. The Holy Spirit wants to make sure we get this. They shared the word of the Lord with him and all who lived in his household. So that means the people in the household heard it, understood it. Even at that hour of the night, the jailer, now look at this. This is now the first mark of a converted life. The jailer cared for them and washed their wounds. Then he and everyone in his household were immediately baptized. You see that? There it is again. Follow salvation. He brought them into his house and set a meal before them. And he and his entire, Holy Spirit keeps wanting us to understand, everyone in his household rejoiced because they all pistos. They all believed. It was a genuine conversion in God. Wow. Absolutely amazing. Look at your notes. By caring for the jailer's welfare, Paul and Silas revealed Christ's mercy to him. Jesus' compassion made the jailer long for more. Isn't that interesting? That's one of the marks of salvation, is that there is a desire for more. He longed for it. He couldn't stay away. He couldn't just do it when he felt like it. It was a compelling process of power in the members of his body. Listen to Chuck Swindoll. When he trusted Christ, forgiveness washed over his soul, changed his life forever. He who inflicted the wounds now bathed the wounds of Paul and Silas in his own home. And they, in turn, wash him in baptism, a moving sense of God's grace. You see how that all fits together? The baptism was almost like this ending of the fact that he washed their wounds and now he's washed. It is an amazing thing. That brings us to the third principle, number three. Praise in hard times reaps a harvest of benefits. That is so important. The greatest results of their faithful attitudes was eternal salvation of a man and his whole family, and they had not been treated unfairly and thrown into prison, they would have missed out on God's tool in salvation. If they would have bypassed this trouble, this problem, this difficulty, they would have short-circuited it. And that ends number four, the remarkable release and the encouragement. They're still bursting with joy. This newfound friends now return to the prison as not to arouse suspicion. Look at verse 35. The next morning, the city officials sent the police to tell the jailer, "Let those men go." So the jailer told Paul, "The city officials have said, you and Silas are free to go. Go in peace." Now, you would think that I would just get out of there and go, right? Look at verse 37. But Paul replied, "They have publicly beaten us without a trial and put us in prison." Now look at, here's the important part. "We are Roman citizens. So now they want us to leave secretly? Certainly not. Let them come themselves to release us." This is great. This is amazing. Rather than accept the official's release, Paul pulls an ace out of his sleeve. Listen to this. Besides being exempt from Roman taxes, Roman citizens had other privileges such as freedom from scourging, from arrest, except for extreme cases, and the right to appeal to the emperor. Likely, Paul anticipated the course of events and determined to withhold the information until it would count for the most on behalf of the group of the disciples to avoid taking steps against members of the infant church. He's really protecting the church from this point on by doing that. So look at your notes. God was bringing light out of a dark situation. See that? And it demonstrates the fourth and the final principle. Look at number four. God's victories are always overwhelming. What do I mean by that? If we let God fight our battles, we are assured that we will conquer through Christ. We don't have time to look, but write down Romans chapter 8, verses 35 through 37. You're going to want to see that. Look that up today. It speaks of the fact that when we are in Christ, we are more than conquerors. We must be sensitive to his moving, for his ways are different than what we expect. Have we forgotten that? And so for Paul and Silas, Timothy and Luke, the wind was shifting back again as they travel on to the next city. Remember, they still have a mission to accomplish. This morning, I want to close with the final Irish blessing. Let's take a look at it. Even if the road crumbles before you, or the wind is at your face, if the sun beats hot upon you, or the storms destroy your fields, even if we never meet again, remember, God will still hold you in the palm of his hand. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for the wonderful truth of your grace and of your mercy. Father, really, at the end of the day, our faith looks up to you. We look to you for the things that we can't change and control. You fight our battles. You deal with the difficulties because we're your children. Father, I pray that you will come upon us in the power of your Holy Spirit and help renew and change us. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus Christ, who's our Lord and Savior. And all of God's people together said, amen.